Hello, I am Dr. Suresh Jinjuwadia. I am a consultant gastroenterologist, hepatologist, and gastrointestinal diagnostic and therapeutic endoscopist. I am practicing in Baroda since 1991. Lower GI endoscopy, generally it is called as a colonoscopy, but in lower GI endoscopy, we can have a different part, and depending on that, it is designated differently. When we say sigmoidoscopy, it's a lower GI endoscopy where we see only the distal part of the large intestine up to the sigmoid colon. The colonoscopy itself requires to see the entire large intestine, that is rectum to the cecum. And when we say ileoscopy, it is the terminal ileum which we intubate through the colonoscope from the ileocecal junction and go into the terminal part of the ileum. So that is called as the ileoscopy. Now, what are the indication of lower GI endoscopy? When do we need to do this thing? The commonest cause for indication for the lower GI endoscopy is bleeding per rectum. If somebody has the blood in the stool, which is of two types. One is the overt bleeding, that means patient sees the blood in the stool, and second is the occult bleeding, that means you have the loss of blood, stool examination is done and stool says that there is a large amount of blood in the stool which is not evident on the naked eye. This is called the occult bleed. The sigmoidoscopy is generally required in a young person who comes with the bleeding PR, and if you want to see if they have a hemorrhoids or some disorder of the anorectal junction. But if you have a patient with bleeding but the age is more than 40, or if you suspect that blood is not from the hemorrhoids, coming from higher up, or if you have a patient who has a hemorrhoidal bleed but age is more than 40, it is very important that you rule out cause from the distal or proximal small bowel, and in that case we do a colonoscopy. Sigmoidoscopy requires a simple preparation of a barium, simple proctoclysis or water enema, which is done as an OPD basis, and then you insert the scope under the local. It doesn't require any anesthesia. While when we do colonoscopy, we need to examine entire large intestine, and when we need to examine entire large intestine, and intestine should be empty of the stomach stool, and there we need to prepare them with a special powder, which is a balanced electrolyte powder, which consists of a small powder, or sometimes it is in the form of liquid, which is diluted with the water, and patient is asked to drink this water, which requires about couple of liters, about 2 liters of water to drink over 2 hours. Sometimes it is given in a split dose, that means half dose in the previous night and half dose in the morning. And after, once you are sure that patient has a clear liquid, no stool material, the colonoscopy is done using a long colonoscope, and this is generally done under short anesthesia or sedation because it is a little painful. Some patient can tolerate it without anesthesia as well, but by and large we do it under anesthesia where we see entire large intestine. The other indication for this is a chronic recurrent diarrhea. If somebody is getting diarrhea, or if you have a altered bowel habit, that means diarrhea with constipation, or some chronic abdominal pain. Especially in the elderly people, this recurrent diarrhea or alternate diarrhea and constipation may be because of the colon cancer. The third indication of this is the screening colonoscopy, specially done in the Western countries because they have a high incidence of colonic cancer, and this colon cancer starts from a small lesion which is called a polyp. So before it turns into the cancer, if you do the colonoscopy and remove this polyp, the cancer in the future can be avoided. And now in India also, we have some patients who have a family history of colon cancer. They have to undergo this screening colonoscopy. So apart from bleeding, diarrhea and cancer, sometimes patient has got a what we call as a severe chronic persistent anemia or recurrent abdominal pain. In that case, sometimes you have a colonic multiple diverticulae, colonic angiodysplasia. Some patients with chronic recurrent diarrhea have inflammatory bowel disease, which can involve small as well as large intestine, where you not only see the large intestine or the colon, but we see the terminal ileum also. Also, apart from viewing this thing, the therapeutic scopy, that if somebody is bleeding and if you see a ulcer in the large intestine, you can do the clipping or the bend ligation and stop the bleeding. Similarly, we remove the polyp from the large intestine using a special equipment. Sometimes early cancer also can be removed using endoscope. And now with the endoscope, we call it the third space endoscopy, where a small deeper lesion also can be removed with endoscopy in past, which was required surgery. I think this is a small introduction for the large bowel and small bowel examination. Now we go for the third type of scopy, and that is called as the endoscopic retrograde cholangiopancreatic scopy. In short, we call it as a ERCP. In past, ERCP was used to diagnose disorder of biliary and pancreatic duct, which now can be diagnosed with a better imaging technique like CT and MRCP. And now the ERCP is mainly used to treat most of the biliary and pancreatic disorder. The commonest one is a obstructive jaundice, where you find stone in the biliary duct and that causes jaundice in the patient. You can do a ERCP, see the stone, remove the stone, and sometimes there is a biliary stricture, that is a narrowing, which causes jaundice. In that case, one can do the dilatation using the ERCP machine and can put the stent in the biliary duct, as we put stent in the upper GI tract or lower GI tract, and relieve the obstruction. Similarly, there are pancreatic disorder, pancreatic stone, pancreatitis, chronic pancreatitis with stricture, pancreatic leak. Pancreatic disorders can also be treated using ERCP scope and various sort of accessories. Thank you.